That I have so much akras atov to, for asking me to come, and also more than I express it, the inspiration to get deeper into the Torah and the world of the tzaddik, of the Baal HaEidula. With Pia Sensner, I want to learn a little bit right now. Lilui Nishmas, of course, the Pia Sensner, and also Lilui Nishmas, one of, in my opinion, his greatest talmidim, who was my first teacher it was actually Ben Ach Shabbatov, from the Rav Nathan Siegel. Who was Rav Nathan's full name?
Rav Nathan Daniel Ben Malka.
Is that by you? Ben Avram Yitzchak. So I've shared with my chaver a few times already that.
The rabbi talk.
There's so much to share, but I want to try to, Hashem should help me just focus right now and get my machshava just together. The personal struggle that many people have delving into this form of the Ish Kodesh is really because of the Ish Kodesh, less about Chovas Talmidim, B'nei Machshava Tova, Derech HaMelech, Tzav Aziz. Because in Ish Kodesh we find struggles in Emuna that at first seem that they oppose everything else about the basics of Emunah Pshuta. Because we know the outcome of the Sefer. You know, we're here because of a Yortzeit, not because the Rebbe lived B'Sefer Tova, but because we don't even know where his burial spot is. L'maisa, for sure. Although I heard there is a Chevra that's trying to gather this year. You saw this? You're trying to put it together to go to the area where they think the... Even that's so beautiful, you know. We don't know, though. We have no idea. But what was the Rebbe davening? I always think about this. What was the Rebbe's tefillah? What were the Rebbe's tefillahs that weren't written, that weren't put in to writing? Specifically, I took a walk a few months ago with my Rebbe's son, my Weinberger's son in Yerushalayim a few months ago. And I said to him, you know, I always wonder, like, I want to stand by the Rebbe right before, the second before he was killed, and ask him, what's the tefillah right now? And he, being the son of a Rebbe, says, it's funny, I always think about like the second after. I want to ask him, what's your tefillah now? The second after you're taken to Ginzei Meron. What's that like? But I think that we actually have the answer to both those questions throughout the Rebbe's writings, I think. And, you know, most of us have grown up in worlds where we've seen people come to shuls and daven and really feel that they're Yotzei Dechova of davening by making sure they were in a minyan. Which is of course correct according to the Pshat Yitzias Dechovas of Halacha of Tefillah B'Tzibur, or Tefillah Bichlal, right? But then the Rebbe pushes us to a place where he will talk right now about Chilul HaTefillah. Chilul HaTefillah, which when we read it, the Rebbe is saying, we're like, wow, I'm so glad the Rebbe said this, because it's what so many of us feel so often when we go to different shuls and see that this can't be what Chazal had in mind when they said you didn't have to come together and daven together. It just can't be. So I want to go right inside the first pieces from the ninth chapter in Chovas Talmidim. The Rebbe says like this, and because of Kotzer Hazman, we're just going to kind of run through this as well as we can, as much as Hashem is Baruch allows us. Yesh choshvim. Shekol atzma shel atfila hi ha-daaga ve-atzarot she'aleha mitpalalim. There are those who think that davening, the essence of davening, is worrying about the troubles, the tzaras that we daven over. So I'm lacking something, I'm scared of something, something's bothering me. That's what davening is for. That's what it's meant. Kmo she'mavakesh he'ani min ha'ashir. Like a poor person asking from a rich person. O kol ish min melech basar v'adam. Or that davening is like the way you would approach how any human being would approach any physical king, flesh and blood. Asher beyado lehoshia be'ezed davar. That the king can answer. As long as you appease the king can give you what you're asking for. And that's how many people approach the concept of davening, the etzem of tefillah, whether they realize this or not. That's what davening is like for them. And now the Rebbe says this line that makes me shake. Aval rak ish ba'ar velo yeda yachol lechalel kol kach et ha'tfila. You know, we talk about people say they talk about their fallings in Yiddishkeit, so they'll say, you know, I was Shomer Shabbos and I started to Mechal Shabbos, and that word even gives you a little bit Chilul Shabbos, Chilul Hashem, right? Mechal Shabbos means you break Shabbos, right? Not literally. Chalal Shabbos means there's emptiness of Shabbos in your life. There's a chalal, right? Chilul Hashem, it means that there's a vacuum, there's an emptiness of this Elokut, kiviyachol, not for real, because Meloch L'Aretz Kevodo, but in your world and in your consciousness. Rak ish ba'ar ve'lo yada yachol lechalel kol kach et ha'tfila. You can cause such a desecration regarding the concept of davening when you think that that's what it's, when you actually believe that this is what it's all about. This might seem lechatchila to oppose a very basic yesod in Rabbi Nachman. I'm a little bit sensitive to right now. I just came back last night in the middle of the night from Oman, so I'm a little bit sensitive to, this happens when you go there and these things kind of because the Rebbe says there you have to come before a child, before a father, asking him for anything in the world. But even the Rebbe would say that maybe that's the beginning. Eventually, a person has to understand the point of tefillah is so much more than that. Here, the Rebbe goes straight to the core and says, when that is your concept of tefillah, you're mechallel, that's the davening. U'lechashva rak tzorich ha'deagot. And you think that davening is only about taking care of worries. U'lulei hitzdar chiyuto lo yamit padel chas v'shalom. And if you didn't need to daven over worries, you probably wouldn't come to a place of davening. You wouldn't even daven. And I always think about this. When was the last time one of us davened so hard, so strong, not from a place of meitzar? Not from meitzarim. Not from narrowness. Just because I was, to me, it's oxygen that's needed. Or some other experience that I felt, but that it wasn't dafka rooted or emanated from a place of meitzarim. There's a lot to say about that, but not for now. So the Rebbe continues over here in the fourth line. Ki be'emes ha'tfila be'atzma, really davening itself, yiskarvus ha'lev v'yishtapchus ha'nefesh la'ashem betfila, hitkarvut ha'lev, it's a very interesting choice of language over here, hitkarvut ha'lev, you getting close to your heart, or your heart getting close to you, or your heart getting close to itself. I'm not a bucky right now, I'm doing this literal translation, except I'm just feeling what I feel with this. V'yishtapchus ha'nefesh, and the outpouring of the soul, la'ashem b'tfila, that I have an experience that my soul is pouring itself before HaKadosh Baruch Hu in davening, that is so much deeper and not necessarily felt when I'm crying over a little bit of tzaras. That's probably not what's felt. When I have worries, and my worries lead me to daven to be asked to be taken care of, I don't know how much of my hishtapchus, of my nefesh, the outpouring of my soul, is what will be taking place. I might feel other things, but to say hishtapchus ha'nefesh, hiskarvus ha'lev, the Rebbe says, zohi ha'ikar asher b'tfila, that's really what davening is all about. Ure'ena b'midrash av yoseh, and look how the midrash takes this further. Lo bilvad, שאין התפילה מסובבס מן הדאגות והצרס, רק שלפעמים את הדאגות שולח השם כדי שנספל אליו יסברך. The classic midrash the Rebbe brings out here, that I feel that when you kind of like have a strong sensory, when you're kind of more refined, I believe a person that taps more into this world of nevuah, the Bnei Machshava Tova energy, you can begin to sense when the Ribono Shel Olam is sending you like tzaras only because of what the Rebbe brought down over here in the Midrash. That it's really a way that Hashem is saying, I want to hear from you. I want to hear from you. That's the Rebbe saying over here. Hashem is Baruch is saying, I want to hear from you, and you're not understanding that in a normal way, so I'm going to send it to you through a worry, through a daga, just so that you can come and call out to me. What's this midrash that he brings over here? Isa v'shmos rabba chuf aleph hei. Omar Rabbi Yeshua ben Levi, lema hadavai domei, lemelech shaya ba baderech, king was walking down the way, v'aisa bas melachim tzo'ek eslo, bevakasha mimcha hatzileini miyad alistim. And a prince, bas melech, right? A princess was screaming, please, please save me from, how would you say listim in English? From,
robbers,
thieves.
Yeah.
Highwaymen. I feel like I saw a bunch of them yesterday in Uman. Shama ha-melech v'hitzila. So the king hears this and he saves. Right? He heard the tzaras. He heard the outcry. And he saves this bas melech from the crying. Le'achar yamin bikesh lisa ota li'isha. And after a while, this king wants to marry who he found, who he just saved. And he would love the princess to speak to him. Ve'lo hayta rotza. Nah, she doesn't want to. Ma'asa ha-melech? Gira ba'halistim kedei she'titzak v'yishma ha-melech. He remembered, wait a second. How was our relationship established in the beginning? There was some tzara, right? What was it? What caused her to come and call and cry out to me? Oh yeah, I'm gonna go to that same cause, which caused the effect, right? Cause and effect. And I'm gonna repeat that just because I want her to come and call out to me again. So he brings somehow Giraba Alistim, he summons, you know, these robbers and these, like, listen, this is the way that I can get her to call out to me again. Ad kan Lashon HaKadosh, right? So this is the Lashon of the Midrash in Shmos Rabbah. It's a nimshal that Rebbe says, Betach ata mevin be'atzmacha. And I love when the Rebbe says this usage of Lashon, which shows up in other places. He's like, look, you and I already knew that halfway through this mashal, you were already starting to become embarrassed and masmik and blushing because you know exactly what we're going through. But just in case you want to like run out of shul now, before the drasha is over, I'm just going to read it. I'm just going to give it to you right now. Your soul, the princess, God wants to marry it. What does that mean? That you should come close and become unified in its holiness. But in order for that to happen, which is what the nefesh, the neshama, always, always wants, lehikalel. Remember, there's a famous statement by the Alter Rebbe. He says, I don't care about Gan Eden Elyon, I don't care about Gan Eden Tachton, Ella, and he quotes the Zohar, leitkalela begufa de malka. I just want to be included. I want to be, not included, it's not the right word. Not even close. It's really what the mashal that you said before, absorbed, like the tipa min hayam that goes inside the yam, and it's already now, you can't be mavdil and say, oh, that's that. And it has a shaychus to the water. Like many of us, like we're into Yiddishkeit, and we have a shaychus to Kedusha. No, you are Kedusha. The Ribono Shel Olam knows this is what the neshama really wants. Hanefesh Shelcha bat mel, again, klomar shetitkarev v'titayached b'kedushato, u'tzricha ledaber u'litpalel elav. Ki al yedei ha'tfila pnimit haba mikirot halev, hanefesh mitoreret mishnata. Through inner tefillah, not the Shacharis Mincha Mariv Yid that has the additions of when things are hard, I cry out to Hashem. But someone that understands that the experience of davening is so much deeper than all of that, it's hard to describe even what that really means. Because any of us that have ever experienced real tefillah, like the Rebbe is speaking about, if you're able to describe what it felt like afterwards, it means it was pretty shmach. Like a lot of my friends that I've seen, lahavdil, that they remember what Grateful Dead shows were like in the 70s and 80s, means you probably weren't there, lahavdil. That's Afi Abdullah, right? But when it comes to tefillah, real, real tefillah, real davening, you're going to explain what it was like? There's iskalus and nefesh at that moment. So this neshama, aldeya tefillah hapnimis haba mikiros alev, hanefesh mitoreret mishne. The soul is, it's enough with the tshluf. Amal mityachedet bamelech, it becomes one with the king, malko shel olam. Vehi ikara v'tachlisa shel tefillah. This is what davening is all about. To realize, ad sheyeshnan deagot shehashem sholeach otan la'ish ha'israeli, that in the middle of my davening over tzaras, I have this moment of being like, wait a second, why am I suffering through what I'm suffering? Kedei sheyitorer al yadam lehitpalel velitzok la'ashem mikerev libo v'nafsho. To bring a person to scream to Hashem, not just help me over here, but to scream from the inner chambers, walls of my heart. Now, Chovos Talmidim was written in
1932.
So we fast forward now 7 years, right? Tafshin. The following piece is a piece I stopped learning Esh Kodesh after learning this first piece for many years, because lo yistader li mashu. I still today can't wrap my heart around the following piece. Because what we just learned, that the Rebbe says that there is this place of davening, there's in the consciousness of a yid, in the awareness of what a yid goes through emes dika davening, through real tefillah, is a sense of, you miss me. You pashut miss me. And that is why you're putting me through what you're putting me through. And that's a very high level, but it's an attainable level that the Rebbe is speaking about over here. But this piece, this famous piece, it's a longer piece, but because we don't have that much time, I just wanted to get to the basar of this piece. It's a famous piece, and I, as a resident of Efrat, who lives 5 minutes from Ari Fold, Hashem Yikom Damo. But really, I don't need Ari Fold as an example right now for the following piece. Just today, 2 more Yidden were stabbed. Not killed, but by Shechem, there was a pigua just a few hours ago. A chayal and a woman. And it's just, you know, over and over again, like the narrative at a certain level really hasn't changed, especially when we meet this thing called Mishpachat HaShchol. Interestingly enough, 2 days ago, tonight's Gimel, right? Today was Bet. Yesterday was Aleph. Seems like centuries ago. Aleph is the Yortzeit of someone who I knew, who's named after the Sefer Esh Kodesh, whose name was Esh Kodesh Gilmore, from Osham of Modi'in. 18 years ago, he was killed while he was a Shomer in Snif Bituach Lomi in Mizrach HaYir. Esh Kodesh Gilmore. And his wife took their daughter, who's now 19 and a half, to the family to pay a shiva call before they went to the askara yesterday. His wife Inbal, his widow Inbal, took their daughter to pay a shiva call by the woman, the family of the woman, the mother of the 2-year-old baby who was killed a few years ago in Barkan, in the Ezor Tasya. They first went to pay a shiva call there and talked about how sad she was that these members were added to her family. Usually we don't say those things when people are added to our family. But there is a family called Mishpachat HaShchol. That's the Rebbe's family as well. And the Rebbe's in that family. The Rebbe might be like the Ava Mishpacha of that family for our generation in the greater context. So if we just learned, I'll try to say this as clear as possible and also as short as possible, if we just learned that an element of tefillah is to get to the awareness that Hashem is saying, I miss you, and that's the ability to go through the de'agot and the tzaras that you go through in order to call out to Hashem, What happens when that gets blurred, when that vision gets blurred due to very, very, very human human conditions, just normal human conditions now? What's quite frightening is that this is the beginning of the war, right? But look how the Rebbe is writing in the beginning of the war. This is mind-blowing. And I have a lot of Hakara Satov to Dr. Henry Abramson for the book that was recently published, where he takes the Rebbe's, he takes the parashiyos every single. It's a beautiful work where he brings the context of what was happening in the war throughout the ghetto and does that parsha by parsha. But for me, this piece in Chayei Sarah is almost like it's been my tefillah ilemet that I've said since I'm a child, being raised in Eretz Yisrael, since I can remember the first, probably since Nachshon Waxman, who interestingly enough, the date of his kidnap was right, is either today or yesterday. So your tzeit's right around now as well. That was a moment in my upbringing that was a very definitive moment. And I think this piece in the Eish Kodesh has been for me a tefillah ilemet. It's like Nachman talks about the tzakata d'mama. Like, I feel very connected to this piece, and we'll see why. V'hine Rashi Piresh. V'lama nismecha mitasar l'akedas Yitzchak. Why is a very famous Rashi there right in the beginning of Chayei Sarah? The last thing that we learn in Vayera is Yitzchak on the Akedah. And the first thing we learn about in Parshas Chayei Sarah is Sarah dying. When did that actually happen? So according to the Midrash, that happened, we know that she was unfortunately received a vision. Someone, the Malach showed her son on the Akedah, and then didn't really show her the end of the story, but just that he was on the Akedah, right? So Rashi says there, parcha nishmasa, her soul blossomed up. That's very interesting, parcha. It just kind of like, usually you say lifrach, to blossom, right? So it's a very interesting usage of words, because parcha, well, blossoming is like nature, beauty, trees, you know, flowers. What's it, parcha nishmasa? He says over here, why was there this smichus? כדי להמליץ טוב בעדינו ולהראות שעל ידי ייסורים חס וחלילה יותר מדי מה נעשה שפרחה נשמסה. So the literal translation of it is like להמליץ טוב בעדינו would be, I'm not even sure how to say that. להמליץ טוב בעדינו. How would you say that?
To advocate on our behalf.
How does advocate on our behalf? So the Rebbe is saying our behalf. Yid in 1939, Poland, our behalf, to show us that through Yisurim that are too much, what are we going to do? Parcha nishmasa.
To show
Hashem.
Huh? To show
Hashem. This is all a protest to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. It's not to show us. I always say that this piece is basically the most essential Hafgana that Am Yisrael has to stand on street corners doing Takadosh Baruch Hu, saying, Ribono Shleinam, with kol hakavod, and this is the holiest chutzpah in the world, Ad Kan. Why? And the Rebbe is going to say, why can we have the chutzpah to say Ad Kan? And the Rebbe says it in such a brilliant way. V'od be'im ken na'asa b'saraf, this was done with Sarah Imenu, this inyan of this kind of protest death. Tzadeket gdola, kmo shebat mea, kebat yisrim lachet. We're talking about Sarah Imenu, such an illustrious tzadekes. Shnei chayei Sarah, shekochan shavim letova, mikol makom, lo yachla lisbol yisurim kashim. He's almost saying, Sarah Imenu died in protest. It was almost a voluntary death, saying, you think a mother can see, get a vision of this, and can continue to exist, and function, and live? Umikol sheken anachnu. If that's the case by Sarah Imenu, how much more so us that are much lower level wouldn't be able to function on any level. Odef Shalomar, shegam Sarah Imenu atzma, shenatna kol kach eliba maaseh ha'akeda, ad sheparcha nishmata, the Rebbe is saying, we could say about Sarah Imenu, she took what she saw, her son on the altar. She took it so much to art, so much so, that she died. Now, this is where it gets a little bit, not confusing, but you've got to be a little bit careful, because you could say that according to this, Sarah Imenu committed suicide, according to what the Rebbe is saying, right?
It's more of that her neshama just couldn't stay it anymore.
No, but in the second.
But in this context, that's true, according to the initial context. But in over here, these words that he just said over here, asta means that she actively did something.
Yeah.
It's not that she couldn't control her soul. It's that she had something to do with the fact she paracha nishmasa. It wasn't ki'ilu, oh my God, I can't take this, look what's going to happen to me. He's saying there was a conscious act over here, the Rebbe is saying. Mitzad tzara imenu. La'arot la'ashem. What was this conscious act? She's showing Kadosh Baruch Hu, ech I efshar li'Yisrael lisbol yisurim yoter midayim. How Yidden cannot take too much. There's a story I heard from Reb Shlomo. I don't remember if it was Reb Baruch Medjibusha and Reb Zusha. I don't remember exactly who the two tzaddikim were. But that one of them was crying. And one of them asked the other, he said, why are you crying so much? So he said, because I see how much koach sibolet Am Yisrael has. I see how much we're so am kshe orif, we can last through so much tzaras. So the Rebbe asked his friend, so why are you crying over that? He says, because of exactly what I just said. So the Rebbe ends over here, these last two lines, and I think about these two lines all the time, since I saw this many years ago. Va'afilu mi shebechemlas Hashem nishachai gam achar yisurav. And even someone with the compassion of Hashem remains alive through such yisurim. Mikol makom, nonetheless, chelkei kulo umocho verucho nishberu ve'nehevdu mimeno. Basically saying, they're like walking spiritual skeletons and physical skeletons. Mali katle kulo, mali katle palge, meaning it's a phrase from the Gemara. What's the difference if a little bit of a person is left or all of him is gone, right? So I feel that the Rebbe gave us this kind of like Pesach HaShaar, to have a very holy chutzpah during tefillah. That on the one hand, the first piece, there's an awareness I can work with to be able to establish the fact that when the Ribbono Shel Olam puts me through something, but it's the agot that are in the framework of normal hevlei olam hazeh, but there's still hard things of this world. I can come to the Ribbono Shel Olam at a certain place and be like, okay, I remember that you miss me and this is what it's all about, right? But then when we go this next shlav, this jump from 1932 to 1939, even us sing Mishpechot Shchol today, this is our tefillah. Ribbono Shel Olam, there are wounds and there are scars. Am Yisrael knows how to deal with a lot of wounds and heal them, v'chule. But then there are scars that Ribbono Shel Olam, is this what you really want? Like, do you want this people walking around with these scars? And that's what their Yiddishkeit is going to be like afterwards, because certain things, like mothers seeing their children on akedas, like the Rebbe was starting to experience nonstop over here, at the end of the day, we are chassidim of Sarah Imenu, and you don't want us to make the same decision, kivyachol, that Sarah Imenu made. And this kind of like dance between these two worlds of tefillah, I feel, make the Esh Kodesh's words so much more relevant to what Am Yisrael, specifically in Eretz Yisrael, is going through day by day. So Be'ezrat Hashem, the Rebbe should be Amei Litzioshi and Shemaim, continue to be Amei Litzioshi and Shemaim, and we should continue to bask in the glory of the Torah of this tzaddik, to be able to find the right words and the right machshavas while we stand before HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and Be'ezrat Hashem will be dancing soon with the Rebbe, with Mashiach Tzidkenu, Amei Rabbi Aminu, Amen.